Hey guys, how's it going? Welcome back to PhysVis. I'm Manas Sharma, and in this tutorial, I'll be showing you guys how to model the 110 copper surface slab using BURAI, which is a GUI for quantum espresso, which also comes with a lot of very useful modeling features. I made quite a few tutorials on BURAI in the past, and recently I also created a tutorial on how to create the copper 100 surface, and in this tutorial I'll be showing you guys how to create the copper 110 surface. So essentially, by the end of this tutorial, we expect to have a surface that looks like this. So as you can see here, we have a top layer where the copper atoms are aligned or stacked vertically right next to each other. And then the second layer atoms are like around 70% visible from the top. And just to make sure, whenever you're modeling such surfaces, it is a good idea to, you know, open some publications that have modeled similar systems, and just to verify whether they are also whether there is agreement in all the structures or not, so that when you finally model your system, you can be really sure that you have modeled the correct system. So here are a few more papers where we can check out the expected 110 surface, how it should look like. So again, here is the 110 surface. So again, you know, you see these U atoms stacked on top of each other with some Cu atoms from the second layer visible from the top. And a similar structure can be seen in this paper as well. So here again, there is a schematic diagram of Cu110, and then there is another figure of Cu110 here. Again, Cu atoms are stacked right next to each other, with the second layer atoms denoted in yellow color here, while the top layer is in red. So from here we can see that almost all these publications, they give the same structure or same appearance of the 110 slab. So we now know what to expect when we model our 110 surface, how it should look from the top. So the first thing that we need is the structural information of the copper cell, and especially the FCC Bravais lattice configuration for copper. So we can get that from the materials project database, and the material ID is MP30 for the FCC copper crystal. And I leave a link to this in the description down below, so you can download it from that. And maybe you may need to log in before you are able to download, but yeah, you can take care of that. I think you can log in with Google as well. So once you are logged in and everything, then you can click on this button over here that says export as, and then export the SIF file to get the structural information. It is by the name cu.sif. Next, you are going to open BURAI. And let me go ahead and arrange it a bit. Yeah, so this seems fine. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to import this CU-SIF file that I just downloaded into BURAI by just dragging and dropping it on the BURAI interface. So here it is, and it looks fine. It is the FCC lattice of copper. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to make it look visually more like what you see in the figures. So in the figures, you never see these bonds, but you rather see these big copper plastic balls kind of thing. So let's try to reproduce that look first of all. So first of all, we'll head over here and then select designer. Then you can just select the ball model and then go ahead and increase the atomic radius to quite a lot. Something like this should be fine, I guess. Maybe slightly more even. Yeah, this sort of looks all right. Maybe I'll make it slightly bigger. Yeah, this is perfect. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to click on the back button, and here is now the new visualization of the copper FCC crystal. And next what we'll do is we'll click on here to open this menu, then click on modeler, and then provide the Miller indices. So essentially, when you say Cu100, Cu110, Cu111, you're essentially talking about the Miller indices of that particular surface. So that basically tells you the direction or the plane along which you need to cleave your bulk system to get that surface. So the exposed plane is basically how it looks is denoted by the Miller indices. So here we will just type in 110 because that is what this tutorial is about, and click on build and then click on OK. And what you can now do is you can, for example, increase the thickness by you know, moving the slider. So now I have a 5 atom thick layer, and similarly you can also, so this is the top view, by the way, that was the side view, and this is the top view. And next what you can do is you can make a supercell out of it. So let's say I create a 2x2 supercell so that the surface now looks slightly bigger. And here is what it looks like now. So first of all, let's have a check on whether is, have we modeled the correct system or not, or the surface is correct or not. So let me reorient it like this and then show you the figures that we just saw. So as I showed you guys over here, that in CU110 surface, the top layer atoms are right next to each other, and then the bottom layer atoms are quite visible, like around 70%. A similar kind of setup you can see over here as well. So these two layers that you're seeing, this and this, are the top layer, while the remaining atoms are from the second layer. So I'm sure you can clearly see this pattern is quite obvious to me. I hope it's obvious to you as well. So I guess we have succeeded in reproducing the 110 plane that we usually see in literature. And the next thing that you need to worry about is the vacuum. So usually it is recommended to have at the very least 15 angstroms of vacuum between the periodic images. So essentially, quantum espresso, WASP, these kinds of plane wave basis codes have inherent periodic boundary conditions. So even if you're trying to model a slab with an exposed surface, it will still, you know, impose periodic boundary conditions, and then you will have a periodic repetition or a periodic image of this surface again in the Z direction. So for example, you can see that the surface is exposed along the Z direction right here. So what these periodic boundary conditions mean is that you will again have another image of the copper slab somewhere over here and then somewhere down here. So yeah, so but you're not really modeling that. You are modeling an exposed slab. You don't really have those periodic conditions in periodic boundary conditions in real life, but there is no way around that except to provide a bit of a vacuum to separate the periodic images of these, you know, surface slabs, so that they don't interact with each other. That is the best you can do, and that is why you need to provide some vacuum. So here, BURAI has by default provided a vacuum of 10 angstroms on both sides, which is quite reasonable. So I think I can just go ahead and click on back and hit yes to save it, and then click back once again and yes. And yeah, so here is the final CU110 surface slab model that we have modeled with BURAI. The new atomic positions are given here, and the new cell parameters are given here. Now, just in case you're not going to be performing a quantum espresso calculation, but rather, let's say, a WASP calculation, then what you can do to convert this structure into the WASP structure is actually quite easy. So you can basically click over here and go to the input file. Go ahead and yeah, so one more thing that you need to take care of before doing that is to select the Bravais lattice and set it to be free, and then reload. What this does is that instead of providing the lattice parameters in terms of A, B, and C that you are seeing right here, it then additionally provides this cell parameters card in the input file where you have the lattice vector. So yeah, that was needed. So yeah, so now let's go ahead and copy this input file and convert it to the let's say the WASP format, or the let's say a CIF file, that is a crystallographic information file. And in order to do that, we will go to this URL where I have created an app that you can freely use to interconvert between quantum chemistry or DFT software file formats. So yeah, so here we are. Let's now go ahead and select the input format to be quantum espresso. Let's find that. Yeah, espresso in. And then the output format we can select to be WASP, let's say, and just paste the control the input file over here. And here it is. So here is the visualization of the system that we have created, as well as the postcard for this particular system that we are getting right now. Now, you may notice that some of the atomic positions, if I come back to BURAI, have these 000 flags right next to them. So they are there because BURAI by default has this setting where it makes the central, or I guess the lower atoms, immovable when you are doing, let's say, geometry optimization. So it will, what it will do is it will ensure that your atoms that are right in the middle of the slab don't move, which is an approximation that people usually make, or like not even an approximation, but kind of a method that people employ to simulate slabs. So that is why it does it by default. But let's say you don't want to do that. You want to relax the positions of all the atoms. You don't want these. So essentially the blue color here is indicating that these atoms are fixed. They are not moving. So as you can see, this is the visualization. So so here this atom is fixed, this atom is fixed, and so on, right? So yeah, so it seems like the bottom three or two layers are fixed. So yeah, so not just the central atoms, but the bottom layer or bottom atoms of this slab are fixed by default. But it is very easy to fix. You can just select you can just select all atoms and then right click again and click on let selected atoms be mobile, and now you won't have any blue atoms over here. And let me also go ahead and not select any atoms. Now if I open the input file, I don't have those zeros next to the atomic position. So now you and which is why also if I come back to this web app that I created, so it had these true tags for the postcard, because that is the syntax in WASP to keep some atoms mobile, I think. Yeah, so the TTT means that this atom's X and Y and Z positions are allowed to be changed, while FFF means that these atoms XYZ coordinates are fixed. So if now I copy paste this new input file from Quantum Espresso over here, and I see the postcard, now you will see that there are no XYZ atoms or the XYZ coordinates of any atoms being fixed. So yeah, so next what you can do is you can also convert it to any other format. Let's say CIF, that is the crystallographic information file, and then you can just go ahead and click and download it, and let's say open it in Vesta, for example. So here is the visualization in Vesta. So yeah, so that is it for this tutorial. I've showed you guys how to model the copper 110 surface. I've showed you guys how to convert this quantum espresso input file to a WASP input atomic positions file, that is the postcard file, as well as how to convert it into a crystallographic information file. I hope you guys found this tutorial useful. In case you did, then don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to my channel for more videos like this. If you have any questions or doubts, you can leave them in the comment section down below. Thanks for watching, and have a great day.